Morning, everybody. Honourable Raksha Mantri, Shri Rajnath Singh, Honourable Governor Punjab, Shri Badnaur, Chief Minister Punjab, Shri Amrinder Singh. I don't see him on the screen, but I believe he's involved in the programme. General R.P. Singh, our Army Commander, North, Western Command, General Shergill, distinguished participants, and all those who are listening to this inaugural program today. I'm indeed very happy to be associated with this morning's event. Over the past 4 years, I witnessed the very steady and meaningful growth of this festival, thanks to the initiative taken by the Chief Minister of Punjab and the Western Command. This event has got fully established as a meaningful annual event, not merely getting together serving and retired service officers, but serious and purposeful discussions which reflect on various important aspects of the defense of India and safeguarding of our territorial unity. I look back, I spent many years in the Ministry of Defense, then in home, then I have served in several troubled areas in the past years. And I feel very proud that over the years, our military has now come of age. I remember in the 1980s, little late 1980s, General Harbakh Singh, former Western Army commander, has written a very, very useful and a very telling book on the 65 war. And there was a furor in the Army headquarters, a furor in the Ministry of Defense. And I happened to be working there at that time. And it is, as I look back, both worrying and regrettable, that our first, very first instinct, very first reaction was how to stop the general pension. How dare he write on a matter like the 65 war without the prior permission of the service headquarters. He had happened to use certain maps of the western border in his book, and they said that technically he should have got the prior approval of the army headquarters and so on. But I mentioned this briefly to say that we have traveled a very long time, and from the very rare occasions when former generals or much less serving officers wrote on any matters military, we now have a galaxy of writings. Every few months, I see a book come out by a former Army officer or former Navy and Air Force officers write a little less than the Army officers, essentially because we have many more Army officers and their experience is far more spread out. So I think that as we go along and we face the challenges along our frontiers, which we are even this morning, we need servicemen not merely wearing uniforms and carrying weapons and using systems and equipments to damage the adversary, but thinking generals, thinking admirals, thinking air chief marshals. Because the wars of tomorrow are not the wars of yesterday. So we have to think in the future, think ahead. And what is more important in recent times, from my own personal experience, I can say that the senior echelons of the military have to now understand the context in which they are operating. Earlier, it was their business, military, and the civilian was civilian, political was political. I think today the senior military echelons have to understand the constitutional framework, their own charter of duties, not the situation within the country, but all over the world. And I'm very, very happy to say that this is already happening. I see a plethora of writing in the newspapers, in the journals, and in some of the books, which shows very commendable insight of some of our service officers. And I wish that this continues and gains strength, because in the past years, I'm sorry to say, we have been very secretive, very confidential, and we have not allowed exposure of documents and literature which are of immense value to the military. I give you one quick example. In the 1980s and early 90s, when I was in the Defense Ministry, we had, with great difficulty, there was no money in those days, finalized the histories, military histories of war. 48 war, 62 war, 65 war, 71 war. And as we went through the process of having them published, there was enormous, enormous opposition. And I say with some personal regret that during my tenure, these books could not be published. One of them got leaked, it got published. And my argument then and today is that experiences of battle, experiences of war, experiences of combat, if these are not recorded well in time, not mythically, but realistically, in official terms, and these writings become available to the cadets who are in various academies, in the colleges of combat and war, in the higher academies like the National Defense College, and other institutions which we fortunately have now, they would not learn. We have also been guilty of not allowing certain reports, like the Henderson Brooks reports, to become available at least to the military system for internal analysis. Learning and experience, where after 30 years, documents are screened and they are removed from the restricted list, from the top secret list, and made available, if not to public, at least in certain archival repositories, like we have various institutions in India where these documents can be kept. And with permission, scholars can go and examine them if we don't want to make them totally open to the public. I would not speak endlessly, because General Shergill has cautioned me that I have limited time to speak this morning. But I would utilize this occasion to give my compliments, my greetings, and my regards to the Honorable Raksha Mantri. And it is a very happy occasion that he is here personally this morning, because it is a very important occasion. And as General Shergill mentioned a little while earlier, there is an inextricable intertwining between matters military and matters civil, particularly in our country. And the more we do to understand both sides of the picture, I think it will lead to greater national strength, build up national security on strong foundations. And I'm sure that this is already happening and will continue to happen. With these few words, I wish this Military History Festival great success. Thank you very much.